Hello and welcome to the United States of America. It's finals day in the World Championships. We're in Deep Creek, Maryland. It's the 2014 International Canoe Federation Slalom World Championships. 380 athletes from 42 nations set out at the beginning of the week. We're down to the last 10 women. We're going to be seeing them competing in a few minutes in the K1 category, and then we're down to the big longboat. It's called the C2s. I'm Matthew Layton. I've got some cracking guests today to talk us through the action. Scott Shipley from the US of A and Joe Jacoby from the US of A. So gentlemen, it is a worldwide audience. You don't have to talk like Americans all the time. Welcome.
Thank you for having us. This is such an exciting final. We were watching the Wint ladies race in the semifinal earlier today. Saw an amazing run by Jessica Fox. I think everybody expected to see that amazing run from her. She's been paddling very well. The big surprise, Luca Jones from New Zealand, who I think all of us knew was very capable of putting down that run, but nobody would have put money on that. She was very, very fast and has really moved herself up to the top of the standings today.
So, yeah, really exciting. We also have Beth Latham. We'll actually go through the list. It'll come on your screen in a couple of minutes, so we're going to be with you for some time. Joe, what are your initial thoughts?
This is one of the most challenging World Championship courses that I've ever seen. I think this afternoon with the women's kayak and the doubles canoe, we're going to be seeing mistakes being made, and on this course the small mistakes become big mistakes very quickly. I think the ones that can capture that and keep them small and anticipate them well are going to get medals today.
Well, that's set up very, very nicely. It's a stunning setup. You can see for hundreds of miles all around you. It's a fairly new course, but it's all the athletes are saying when they arrived they weren't sure. Now they've all fallen in love with it. This is the lineup, the top 10. They're going in reverse order of the times they qualified in the semifinals. So we had 53 girls at the beginning of the week, 30 in the semifinals this morning. So they have seen exactly this course about 2 hours before, gone down it. And what we'll see is starting off by Beth Latham. What we're going to do is we'll give you a few details about the actual individual athlete, and we'll have our experts talking us through it. Apparently Beth, she's a cool customer. She's not a new newcomer. She's done well in the Europeans this year, making the final. Last year in Cardiff, she made the K1 final. But if you look at her results this year, she's way above her league. Let's see if she can hold it together.
Well, and I watched her semifinal run. She was very, very efficient through this course. Very well. And really, that's the name of the game. A lot of these athletes are having trouble with the technical parts of this course, but they're also losing time in some of the easier moves just because they aren't keeping that boat moving. She really kept it moving this morning. Let's see if she does it again.
21 years old, as I say, having the time of a ride of her life, hopefully.
This top part of the course can be really tricky. You'll see folks in the 4-5 maneuver, how fast can they get in, how fast can they get out? We want to see them get in and out on one stroke, and we saw that in the men's kayak yesterday with the French team as they came down and finished 1-2-3, all of them in and out of those gates. 8 and 9 are very sticky, so can they get across there high and efficiently without having trouble with the squirrels, as you see there on the 80 line? And she was very tight on the gate 9. I'm going to wait and see what the judges say about that.
Reference points is the fastest qualification was 118 seconds, and 10th place was 123. But she's picking up a 50-second penalty. She's not going to like that.
Yes, a lot of trouble there in gate 9. And I think that's a gate that a lot of athletes have had trouble with over the week here. So at this point in time, she probably doesn't realize that she's missed that gate, either that or she's just hoping the judges didn't see it the way she saw it. And she's still racing for the gold here, and actually quite quick. And it's a good time to talk about this 15-16. That's where the American Michael Smolin lost a lot of his time. It's not ostensibly as tricky or as fast as a lot of the maneuvers, but they have to get between those gates very, very quickly. This is where we're seeing a lot of time get wasted on this course.
I think one of the things that strikes me about the water in this section, Scott, is that the water's not always working for you. This is one where you really got to add your own juice to it.
Oh, and more trouble there. She's sort of racking up. Well, and she'll go back for that, but had she missed those gates, bear in mind, if you miss a gate, it's 50-second penalty. If you take a touch on the gate, 2-second penalty. If you simply go back for a gate, as she did, there's no penalty at all, but it takes some time to do that.
Well, first of 10 competitors to go in the K1 finals. It's this finals day here. Weather, we're a little bit late, apologize for that, but there was a bit of a storm that came over. So sensibly, the organizers said, let's hold off. Hopefully now we have a couple of hours window where we can have fair conditions. And she crosses the line, 179.88. The thing to remember is she has made the final.
Well, I'll tell you what, you know, that run's not going to stay in the lead, obviously, with the paddlers that are coming on this course. But it's nothing for Bethan to be ashamed of. She has had a fantastic World Championships. Even making this final is a great accomplishment. I'm looking forward to seeing how she races in the coming years as we lead up to Rio.
Melanie Pfeiffer, the first of three Germans in the final today. She's been around a long time, got great experience, and knows how to win.
Well, and the thing about Melanie is she is very precise. You look at her and you say, gosh, she's not pulling that hard, or maybe she's not going that fast, but the reality is she really is. She's just very good at using the water, very good at putting the boat in the right place. This is certainly a medal contender. In spite of qualifying ninth, I think we could see her on the stand. This run.
Well, it's been a long season. It started well. She came second in the Europeans in Vienna earlier in the season and just kept it going together. So it's a 6-7 month season so far.
You know, the last time I saw her race was at the test event for London. She qualified in 10th place, barely made the final, and then won that event. So this is a very capable athlete for the German team.
I say, she's 52 seconds off, but we don't have a fair reference as Beth took a 50-second penalty. But we looked for the fastest was 1:18 a couple of hours ago.
I think what's really impressing me about her paddling right now is how light the boat is on the water and looking very effortless, meaning that I think she's going to have some strength and power for the bottom of this course.
Well, I'll tell you what, on day one, France was very strong. Three men's kayaks in the final, three men's kayaks in the end. Germany had a very tough day, only one medal in the men's C1 bronze medal. But now I look at this final, hey, three German girls in the final. I wonder if we won't see three German girls on the stand.
It has been a precedent. We saw in 1993 in Italy, we had France 1, 2, and 3 with Marion Fox leading out the medals.
Absolutely, absolutely. And they were a very strong team that worked very well together, as this German squad does. And she is very quick to that hard 18-19 move.
Really good through the bottom of the section. She's got everything she needs to put a good result.
That is very fast. I've got to believe that this is going to be the time standard that the later girls are chasing as we move forward. This is a very, very fast run by Melanie.
And crucially, it's clean.
Melanie now sprinting to the finish. This time is going to come in. Wow. That is time. 9 seconds in raw time, at least, faster than the previous competitor. So she's got a smile on her face, doesn't she? She's very excited about that result.
Concerts. Great thing about the, I guess the TV images weren't quite the same 25 years ago. You couldn't look into their eyes as much, but I guess it's a, you know, really what I'm thinking now.
I think at the end of the day, it's interesting. There are two very capable German girls to follow her. It may well be a teammate that pushes her out of the first place spot.
Fiona Penny has world championship medal experience. Hasn't had the best season so far, but she's strong, she's enthusiastic. She trains with two of the top British boys, so she's used to really giving it.
Well, and Britain has also had a tough World Championships. David Florence, you know, defending world champion, not in the final in the C1, also not in the final in the C2.
And that's why he's coming in to see us in about half an hour's time.
Yeah, absolutely. He'll be actually commenting, commentary on the C2, so I'm looking forward to that. But I got to believe that the British girls are now looking to bring home a little hardware for the team.
I think what really strikes me about Fiona's style, especially after Pfeiffer, is just a lot more power, a lot more strength into this, and you see it on each stroke. You see that boat isn't quite as light on the water, but she's just so strong. She's getting a lot of bite on each stroke, Scott.
Well, and if you look at the approach that the girls have had in relation to the men, the men's race was a desperate race. It was very wild, a lot of risks being taken. You look at Fiona here, she's doing the full spin at gate 15. She's picking that conservative line, but she's executing it very, very quickly. It might have been a little close on the poles there. We'll see what the judges say. She's executing it very well and moving the boat very well. So this is becoming a very fast race, but not quite as crazy as the men's kayaks were.
Well, this has been the crucial move. She's 5 seconds up. That's huge.
She is absolutely flying here.
She wants a medal, doesn't she?
She is, and she's still clean, so she's really moving that boat well, and she's staying off the poles. This could very well, despite what I just said, take Melanie out of the lead.
There's the Brits cheering along, shouting along, very popular.
Well, at this point, it's just a sprint to the finish. She has really put down a run here. This
1:20 to go for it. She's going to be way ahead.
Certainly take the lead here.
Very nice here.
Bravo.
Five
there is happiness.
Faster. That is absolutely amazing. And she felt that she knew she had that top run.
What's funny though, she was with us in the commentary box in Augsburg, and she gave the same reaction of joy when Joe came second. So she feels it for herself, but she also feels it for the others.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Fantastic how the athletes in the sport really do support each other. It's a very, very competitive sport. A lot of rivalry. Look how close she was off that pole without hitting it.
Four seconds faster than anyone in the semifinal. That's going to say, girls, come and get me.
Yes. Well, and what's amazing is I think Fiona had every right to say, gosh, I was good compared to the qualifiers. This is going to be a very fast time and then beat by the next lady.
Different style, different generation. 22 years old, Ricarda Funk. Two wins in the World Cup so far this season. Won the Europeans.
Well, and Ricarda, a very young, new talent. It's just not a name that we've heard a lot before this year. And she is absolutely flying. Especially if you look at just the stroke rate she's bringing to this course. She wants to win this race.
Very aggressive out on the water. This is the first time I've had a chance to see her paddle in person, and having a little bit of trouble keeping the boat speed moving through gate 9, Scott.
One of the things you run into in canoe slalom is you can go sprint, but at the end of the day, putting that extra effort in may or may not pay off because of the risks involved. And so she lost a little time there, and now
she
has to
cost her 5 seconds off it. So she just needs to hold it together. Don't panic.
And it looks like the judges have seen two touches out there. She's got a total of 4 seconds in penalty time, but she is absolutely hammering down this course.
Well, I suppose you've got nothing to lose, have you, when you realize you're behind it and Fiona's just putting a storm in time.
Well, I'll tell you what I see in this sport from quadrennium to quadrennium is that you get some great champions who race in the Olympics. They do very well in the Olympics, and then they can hang on for a couple of years. And if they're not hungry, they start to get replaced by a new guard. And Ricarda is very much a part of that new guard. She has been very quick in taking a lot of medals from some very experienced paddlers this year.
I'm not sure she's going to medal today, but I'd say she's had an extraordinarily good for season so far. 11 seconds off the pace coming to the difficult move.
And that kind of time gap, she's really racing for time right now, but that kind of time gap is virtually impossible to make up on a race course of this length. But she's certainly someone we're looking for results from in the future.
I think here at the bottom of the course, too, I think we've seen a lot of German boats, a lot of British boats. You can look at the individual paddlers, but it's hard not to be thinking a little bit about their systems, too. I mean, where they develop their talent, the values that these countries bring, that it's just a very champion's mindset. You know, here in the finals of the World Championships, it's very cool to see.
Fiona's deception on her mind.
Yeah, Fiona safely hanging on to that lead. And you can see she's sort of nervously watching that clock as each paddler comes down the course.
I think she might be set there for a while. She certainly looks like it. But yeah, Ricarda, as I say, 22 years old, big future.
I'll tell you what's interesting about where Fiona's sitting right now is I think Jessica Fox, a lot of people were expecting a win out of her and perhaps a comfortable win based on how well she paddled this morning and how confident she was this morning. Having said that, really, Fiona's put it out there, quite a challenge for this this finals run.
Karina Kunle, 27 years old, having a storming season so far and is, remember, the world champion of 2010 and 2011, but that's not the start she wanted. She had the same mess up in the Olympic Games. It all fell to pieces.
I'll tell you, this is a paddler who, when she's on, she is absolutely on. But I've seen it fall apart before, and it usually starts early as it has here. So let's see if she can pull it back together again.
But this is the exact kind of course where there's just going to be a lot of mistakes made out there today. It's all about getting that mistake behind you. So let's see if she can do that.
Oh, and a lot of trouble there on the eddy line. What these paddlers want to be doing is squeezing out of eight, using their hips to shoot across that hole and literally shoot right into nine and turn on a very quick backstroke.
7 seconds down. It's not the best day in the office.
You have to wonder as well, is that time of Fiona putting a lot of pressure on these athletes? Hey, we have to not be just good. We have to be great if we want to get on that top podium spot at this point.
A lot of the athletes said they don't want to listen to the overhead system, but it's impossible, I guess.
It's in your ear. It's in your ear. And these athletes very well know the time to beat out there, and now they know that time to beat has gotten faster.
No, it's just falling apart, unfortunately.
This is a very different athlete. You know, I watched Karine race when she won the World Championships in Bratislava in 2011, and she was all powerful there. She was just absolutely online, very near where she lives, home course advantage, and she absolutely put that boat where it needed to be, and you could see the power in her strokes the entire way down. This run is very different. She's sort of fallen apart and taking a lot of penalties. I think she knows she sort of lost her World Championship bid for 2014.
We're finals day. Scott Shipley, Jojo Kobe, and we've had five now of the athletes down, so it's starting to be at the stage where you think, I could get a medal here.
Yes, well, absolutely. You know, there's a very high standard for first place. There's a big gap there between the first place time and the second place time at this point. There's definitely room for medals at this point for these athletes coming down soon.
Fiona saying, I'm still there. No, unfortunately, as I say, we have to stress that she has made the final, which Jana Dukatova didn't, Emily Fair didn't, Nuria Newman didn't, and a lot of the girls with lots of gongs around their neck before haven't managed to come through today.
Well, and I think the big story is Mylan Schouten, the Spanish girl. She won the qualifying bronze medalist from 2012, a very powerful, very nimble athlete, which was playing very well on this course up until that semifinals, and then she also failed to qualify.
Carole Buzidi from France going next. Perhaps again, one of the she had good results in the Europeans a couple of years ago, and but hasn't really justified herself this season so far. So it'd be interesting to see if she can hold it together today.
Well, and if anybody has figured out this course, it is the French team. They were very successful in the men's kayaks, have been paddling very well in all of the classes, including the C2. It was a bit of a surprise, to be honest, that Emily Fair, the Olympic gold medalist, world champion as well, was not able to make it into this final. So tides have turned a little bit on the French. But for this lady, so hopefully she will put in a result commensurate with her teammates.
So far, three World Cups this season. Lee Valley 38th, and Say 13th, and Augsburg 19th. So she's on a stormer.
Yep, it's an uphill battle. This will be her best, no matter what happens at this point.
I've spent a lot of time around the French program this week, and the athletes, the coaches have really been enjoying their time here in the United States, and I just think that speaks to something when these athletes try to unload some of the nerves. She's having problems there on the gate. She's going to have to go back for this one.
This section of the course, Savage Falls, it's a very clean wave at the top, but the water below is very swirly. It surges and it pushes in an irregular fashion, and so it's very easy for these athletes to do something that looks like they're on line, but then the water changes, and they're really off the line and miss the gate just as she did. So that very much is the end of her world championship bid.
So we only have, well, we'll keep talking about it, but we only have four athletes left. Now, not being rude to you, but let's talk a little bit about the course, Scott.
The course out here is very, it's a very powerful whitewater course. It's actually a pumped course, and so a lot of folks don't realize when they look at this is this water is, you turn on a switch and the river runs, and you turn that switch off and it literally dries up. And so these athletes have come here really for the first time for international competition. It's a very different course to what they're used to. And I think that's part of the reason why we're seeing so many penalties on these runs, is the athletes are having a hard time making that adjustment.
Well, she's coming to the end of her course. Carole Buzidi, only French athlete to make it into the final. And she finishes in provisional fourth place. However, we only had six athletes gone down so far. But we've got some, it's going to be wonderful. The next four athletes, for different reasons, they all can claim a place to win. Stepanka Hilgatova, we don't get too much on about age, but 46 years old, been to all the six Olympic Games. And Joe, what does it feel like an old bloke competing at the top level?
Well, I spent some time with Stepanka this week. You know, the neat thing is I don't think she thinks about that a lot. This is just a process for her. This is a process that she just is evolving for years and years and years. And I don't think she thinks a lot about being old as much as she just thinks about trying to be a little bit better, small increment or improvement each day.
Last twice out, she took the bronze medal and silver medal in the World Cups.
I'll tell you what, it bears noting, this is an Olympic gold medalist that we're watching here. She's a very talented athlete towards the end of her career. One thing that's very interesting is the USA is very proud to be holding these world championships. We have not held it in 25 years. 25 years ago, we held it here in Garrett County, Maryland. Stepanka is the only athlete left in this race who actually competed in those past world championships. So a little bit of history here, and America is very proud to have her back for a second time.
Well, she also likes America for another reason. She picked up her first Olympic gold medal in the United States in 1996 at the Olympic Games.
Well, let's concentrate on a run for a couple of minutes because it is looking like it's a good one.
She is flying down this course. Again, taking the conservative route in 15. If you do that, you need to be tidy, and she wasn't. You need to turn and go. And she sort of turned and stalled, and now she's fighting that loss of momentum through the slow water. And again, that just eats up time compared to what Fiona did.
It shows the confidence that she says, perhaps I can't go for the gold, but at least I want to get a medal.
Right. At this point, it may be a good strategy for her. It may very well be a good strategy. Very tricky move coming up here at 18, 19. Let's see how she does.
Poles are wobbling around a little bit.
Oh, and good but not great there as well.
Creating a teeth caddy for you.
That'll work, though. That will work on a day like today where there's a lot of big mistakes being made.
I'll tell you what's interesting is it seems to be that finals often are great and everyone or people all struggle. Fiona put down that early run, I expected to see the girls flying after that. And really, since that time, most of the girls have struggled to put a result in at all. So Stepeka's doing quite well here.
Let's see if she goes into the top three places, it looks like. Where is she at the moment? Third place. Well, I think it's good. But
it's a good result for Stepeka. I don't think she'll hold on for a medal. I think there's some good quality girls coming. She doesn't have to wait long to find out, though. Next boater down will be Jasmine Schornberg, who's a very, very competent paddler coming into these finals.
2009 world champion at a course you know quite well, Joe. Are there similarities between Lasea and here?
I think that the water's a bit more jumbly here. I think that it's a little bit less predictable. I think this course has some of the more less predictable water of any of the courses that these athletes race on.
There's a very tense Fiona. She knows she's one racer away from finding out if she'll medal, guarantee a medal or not. Jasmine, I watched this morning, she was absolutely flying down this course. When you talk about keeping the boat moving, she was keeping the boat moving through a lot of very difficult whitewater. Top part of the course, she's doing the same thing again.
Well, she's so far, we've had seven athletes. Fiona Penny's in the lead. Melanie Pfeiffer's second, and Stepanka Hilgatova is third. The third time is 1:24.77. That's where you have to beat. So far, she's 2.46 seconds down.
Well, I'll tell you what's interesting is I watched this top bar of the course. I don't see anything to criticize. Having said that, she's still 2.5 seconds behind Fiona. It's just testimony to how fast Fiona really was going out there.
A little bit low in 14. I remember watching Schornberg win that gold medal at the World Championships in 2009, thinking this is an era about to go. And then she kind of came down, and now she seems to be building her results back up again. It's good to see her in the final.
28 years old. Olympics and wants to win some more stuff.
Well, Jasmine seemingly very good through 15-16, but taking a lot of time getting from 16 to 18. Like I said, you can burn time up here and people don't really see it, but at the end of the day, it shows up on the watch.
She's going for third place. Third place is 9.8 seconds back, and she was virtually 6 seconds down at the split.
Oh, and she is burning time up in 18 as well. This is a run that went from good to okay to now she's losing time.
I think it's going to be hard for her to catch even Hilgertova in the third spot right now.
Fiona Penny, let's look at her when she finishes because she's guaranteed herself a medal.
She really needs to be pulling at this point in time as she comes down the course, and she's sort of fighting with the water, carrying a little speed across the finish line, so let's see where this comes in.
Well, she's fifth place. It's not what she wanted. So to summarize, eight athletes gone. Penny from Great Britain, 1:14.97. Melanie Pfeiffer, second. Stepanka Hilgertova in 1:24. No penalties, two penalties. It shows you need to go clean.
You absolutely
need to be very fast.
Well, and one athlete who can do it, who is someone everybody here is excited to watch, is Luca Jones from New Zealand. A lot of people didn't suspect she would be sitting in second place after the semifinals. She was on an absolute flyer of a run. If she can do that again, she is guaranteed of a medal.
Well, I was sitting doing the commentary with Mike Dawson, who was jumping up and down a couple of hours ago in the semifinals. It's her first time on the major world scene.
Well, New Zealand is a very small country. There's not a lot of folks there compared to some of the powerhouses in this sport. Having said that, they've reliably produced a number of great kayakers. One of them, actually, Donald Johnson, who raced here at the Savage River in 1989, he will certainly be watching her as she comes down this course with his fingers crossed that New Zealand brings home a medal this time.
Well, she's in touch, 2.28 down, and they credit a lot of work done by Campbell Walsh, who's been dedicated for the last couple of years to the team.
Well, Campbell, a great technician from the British team, a number of years on the podium there, including an Olympic silver medal. He brings a lot of capabilities and a lot of knowledge to this program, and he is very excited about what he sees in both Jones and Mike Dawson.
Well, she's having the run of her life.
She is absolutely flying through here, and she takes that high-risk maneuver, and it does not pay off. That is absolutely tragic for her. This is somebody who may have done better to take a more conservative line given the results that were on the board earlier. I think she said, no, silver is not good enough for me. I want to win, and to win, I need to take those risks. And having taken those risks now, she's had to pay the piper.
Well, it's her choice.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. But I'm disappointed. I would love to have seen a New Zealand flag flying over that stand today.
Well, it does mean, well, the crowd's gone quiet because no one likes to see someone going for it and not succeeding.
Well, and when I think back, you know, the one thing that comes to mind in all of this is we're all starting to look at, hey, how does this class line up for Rio 2016? You know, a couple of years away, who's going to be in the finals? Who's going to be racing in that race? Who's going to medal in that race? And Luca has certainly sort of noticed at this site that, hey, I'm a factor. You should be thinking about New Zealand when you're thinking about which anthems to put into the cassette deck before
she
we get
blew
down.
Up as well in the final in Augsburg a month ago. It was gate 22, I think. She took her, they said, take the S choice, and she didn't, and it went against her, and then it all went wrong. But you've made the final, first ever time you've made the final. Well done. We now know that Fiona Pleny has at least the silver. Melanie Pfeiffer has at least the bronze. And we know that Jessica Fox might make history.
Listen, this, you can absolutely feel the tension in the crowd here. Everybody from America remembers Richard Fox and Miriam Brusalami and how well they did when they raced here in 89. This is a name that everybody in the paddling family knows. Everybody's excited about Jessica Fox. You can hear the crowd cheering for her in the background. Everybody's excited about this paddler.
And so far, she has won the C1. So she's the world C1 champion. Last year in Prague at the championships, she won the C1 by 13 seconds. Didn't make it through the final. How's she going today?
She is absolutely flying through these tricky parts. This is the one split time that we've seen so far that's going to even challenge what Fiona's done.
Well, they're fairly close.
They're very close.
Yeah, it's absolutely understatement there. This run is world championship quality, and she is not seemingly having any trouble doing it. She's very relaxed out there, and she is motoring down this course.
Well, we saw about an hour ago talking to her father, Richard, just in front of us. Big smiles between the two of them. It's a go for it, girl.
Well, she may tie the family record for a single world championship here when you add up her parents' medals. So
every time they compete in America, they win, don't they?
Absolutely. Well, and I think a lot of people were surprised. Everybody knows Jessica's a talent. A lot of people were surprised when she came home with silver medal from London. She's still very young.
20 years old.
Yes, and she's really lived up to that name.
This is the crucial next 5 seconds.
Oh, that's beautiful.
She's done it.
Wow. That's perfect.
Listen, I think we are watching a gold medal run here. She is stomping down this course. She's absolutely
flying. See where the split is.
She's gotten stronger. She's gotten more consistent, and you see it really coming out at the right time.
A little trouble at 22. Nothing to worry about, but squirrely and a little bit of time spent there. I wonder how that's going to affect her lead.
1:14.97. It's going to be so close.
She needs to get a move on if she wants to take this medal home, and I think she's done it.
She's world champion.
She has done it.
She's double world champion.
She has absolutely done it. That is a history in the making. She has won 2 gold medals at the same world championship, one in C1, one in K1. What a remarkable accomplishment.
Well, there's Ballant on the official ICF photographer. He's got the best view in the house every week. He covers all sports.
Listen, this was absolutely amazing to see. It was amazing to see Miriam win in 89. It was amazing to see Fox win. And now Jessica doing the same thing twice over here in 2014.
She even skipped Augsburg last time because she had to go and be an ambassador for the Youth Olympic Games a couple of weeks ago. But yeah, well, extraordinarily well done, Fiona. Maybe a bit sad at the moment, but I'm sure when she reflects, it's something extraordinary she's done.
Well, at the end of the day, that is some tremendous paddling by Fiona. But for her, the world champion, Melanie Pfeiffer as well from Germany, bringing home another medal for the German team. She had a remarkable run, and she did it very early on in this class. She set that standard.
We've seen Miriam just running across the bridge in front of us. She's going to be let's hope she doesn't jump in the water. It's not like the London Olympics, but she's just running across to congratulate her daughter.
Well, I think it's an interesting support structure that she has. Her mother and father actually are the Australian Paddling Federation in the sense that her mother is the coach, her father the high performance director. She has basically been raised to be the champion that she is, and she does very well with it.
And that's nice to see Roz Lawrence whistling away saying, well done.
Absolutely. One of the neat things about that Australian team is that they are very deep in the ladies' class. We've seen a lot of medals from Australia in the ladies' class that didn't have Jessica Fox's name on it. Now it's Jessica's turn, and it's great to see.
Just to show you what's going on, to cool down a little bit, the women K1 final has just taken place in Deep Creek, Maryland, United States. The winner is Jessica Fox. The second, Fiona Pleny, and Melanie Pfeiffer is the third place. Moving down, we have Hilga Toga, Funk, Schoenberg, Bazidi, Kunle, Latham, and Jones. It's a wonderful final. You guys, your hearts are beating a bit, I guess?
This has been such an exciting race. The semifinals were very exciting, and then to see all those great athletes progress to the finals and see Jessica with the run she just had. This is absolutely an amazing day.
And we saw the first split, 1/100th of a second behind, and then she was 99/100th ahead, and then she just did an amazing maneuver, 18-19, and kept it together.
She just continued to claw ahead and ahead. And
I'm going to have to go back to this, sorry. Just to confirm the official announcements, it's Jessica Fox, Australia, takes the gold medal. Fiona Penny, Great Britain, takes the silver. And Melanie Pfeiffer, Germany, takes the bronze. It's all yours.
Oh, I just want to go back to that run and the way that she progressively got faster and faster and faster and widened her gap as she went down that run. It was a very quick run. It continued to get quicker as she went. That was world championship quality.
As you can see in the pictures, we have Fiona Penny hugging Yasmin, hugging Paul, the team director, hugging everyone. So I think they're delighted with it.
Well, I would also just add in addition to just being making those improvements on the water, she's so good off the water. She's such a great ambassador. You mentioned the Youth Olympic Games. She's someone that is representing both the development of women's canoeing, now really the force to be reckoned with, as you said, heading into Rio 2014.
Helga Taggart, so much experience, and we have the Czech journalist there pushing the information back home that Stepanka has stepped up once again.
She was very much a big factor in this race. There's a lot of experience in this final. You know, finishing in fourth just out of the medals is a great result for her as well. I know she wanted to finish higher, but it's just a testimony to the level that these girls have brought it to in the last few years.
Moving on quickly, we got two events today. It's the C2. Joe, you know something about these. Just to remind our guests tuning in for the first time, Joe Jacoby was the Olympic champion from 1992. So you know a little bit about this, and talk us through the guest list.
Well, I think it's who's missing from the guest list. We've got absent are the Hawkshorners, the three-time Olympic champions. And, you know, look, as we look at this race, let's talk a little bit about what's going to be successful, what's going to be a gold medal winning run in these world championships. This is going to be such a hard course for the world championship gold medal in C2. There's going to be a lot of mistakes. Who's going to reduce those mistakes? Who's going to minimize those mistakes? Who's going to keep these mistakes small before they become large? That's who you're going to see at the top of the podium at the end of this race.
Well, just stacking up from the block, it's Great Britain's David Florence, who's probably a little bit tired because I saw him running down the course a couple of minutes ago, cheering on Fiona Penny. David, welcome.
Yeah, thanks very much. That was pretty exciting from a British perspective. I have to say, I thought after Fiona's run that she was in with a very, very good chance of winning that. And hats off to her and Jess, who both put in fantastic runs, really, and Jess with under that pressure at the end of it.
Well, that's great. I'd say you're joining us live from Deep Creek. David Florence, not being rude, but you haven't had the best weekend. Not being rude, sorry, you haven't had the best weekend, but you were the world champion last year in C1 and C2.
Yeah, not been my weekend. That happens sometimes in canoe slalom. Obviously, it's disappointing when it does. But you know, we've seen that with a number of other good athletes. But got the C2 to watch now. So
let's move on. Skantars. It's a bit of a surprise to see them first off, I guess.
Yeah, they've undoubtedly been the most dominant crew this year in C2. They've been looking really good. But and just snuck into this final. But that looks off to a reasonable start there. That first move, I have to say, is not particularly easy for the C2 crews, even though it might look it. The Hoschner brothers going back for it twice in the qualification stage.
I don't think there's any gimmies on this course in the C2. So, Dave, let me ask you a question. Starting at the front, this is, you don't get the information of a lot of other boats. What kind of things are you telling a doubles canoe team as they start this race, first boat off the course? Are you telling them to go big or go conservative? What are you thinking if you're first off the line?
Yeah, it's... I mean, my tactic is always to try and put in the run that I think is the best run I can deliver. And sometimes, particularly on this course, that might be hard to evaluate. So much of this course is about get 18-19 in the C2. It's a phenomenally difficult move. You've obviously got a very easy option to go around the bottom, but probably significantly slower. I honestly don't know what we're going to see from crews, whether they're going to take on the hard move and really go for glory, or think other people are going to mess it up and go around the bottom.
Well, we're about to get our first look at one of the key moves coming up at 18-19 in a moment here. We talk a lot about C2 family. You know, you get to know these guys well. What's the skinny on the Skantars? How do you see them when you race against these guys?
Yeah, I really like them. They don't speak a huge amount of English compared to some of the other foreign guys, but they seem like real friendly, nice guys. And there we go. They're going opting for around the bottom. That is interesting. So first boat off, they've had a fairly solid run so far, and they've opted for the safe option to put in a good run. So, you know, knowing they're getting something on the scoreboard rather than taking the huge risk for that faster move.
But we saw in the Worlds last year, you and Richard, you took some choices as well, didn't you?
Yeah, it was a hard course last year as well, and we went for the slightly safer moves, and it paid off on that occasion. But I don't know that everyone's going to go for that more conservative option.
Well, let's see what time they get.
They've got a clean run, which is very exciting.
1:28.
Yeah, and that was... They look pretty solid all the way, I'd have to say there, Joe. Yeah. No major errors. On this course, there's always a bit of reliability on the water. You get pushed around a bit.
That would have given them, by the way, third place in the semifinals.
I think as soon as these guys decided to go low on 19, a lot of information was being communicated up to the C2s in the start pool.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what the guys know.
Well, Matt Lister in the back of the British boat, he's been tweeting up until about 20 minutes ago how he's excited about this.
Yeah, these boys will be really excited to be in there at their first World Championship final. I'm pretty confident to say that we'll see them take on the safe option again as they did on their first run. So it'll just be about trying to deliver the rest of the course as best we can and stay clean. Matt picked up a little touch on five on his first run, but he's managed to get fast and clean around there this time.
You know, Dave, I think with your level of performance over the Olympics, the World Championships last year, the pride in what it means to be a C2 in Great Britain, it's changed dramatically. Talk about what it must be like for these guys being a part of this program right now.
Yeah, we've got a lot of C2s, which is not something we've traditionally had. Coming up to the split, 100th off the Scantar. So for these guys, this is a fantastic run. C2 class has come a long way in Britain in the last 4 or 5 years, I guess. You know, these guys have come on a lot as well. Not regulars to finals or anything. Made the final in London with some fantastic times, but a few penalties getting in the way. But they're looking really solid so far.
I love the way this boat is looking right now. They look like they're going to have plenty of strength and power for the bottom of the boat.
That's going to be expensive.
Unfortunately, just drifting in. That's a difficult move in the C2, that spin on the wave. In C2, even more so than the single boats, it's really hard to both know exactly where your other paddler is when you're going backwards through the gate. And they obviously just misjudged that slightly, took that penalty. Is it going to cost them on the split?
Well, they're 1.6 seconds down. Here's the crux move.
Yeah, I think the touch wasn't added on yet, so they're looking like they're more like 3.6 down at that split, sadly. Touch there. I think a great start for Davies and Lister has maybe unraveled a little bit towards the bottom here.
Maybe a little bit, but you know, we are going to see a lot of mistakes made today, and it's just the operating phrase is keep looking forward in a race like today.
Yeah. Will the fact that Matt Lister's carrying a bit of an injury and can't pull as hard as he likes, or he's just going to go through the pain barrier?
He's suffering from a bit of a rib injury, but these guys seem to have been managed to train and race all right.
Well, they're coming 7.35, and he was so excited about making the final, and I think they just need to celebrate getting this far.
Yeah, to be fair, I think there were maybe a 1-2 one, was it, on first runs? A bit slower on that second run, but they did a lot of things really well there, and it's a hard course for everyone.
We saw that they really seemed pleased with the run, that they were really enjoying themselves out on the water, which is a huge thing at World Championships.
Another crew here who, Joe, we've not seen in a lot of finals, these guys. Very good on sail. Maybe this course being a slightly natural style artificial course has helped them, but yeah, they'll be, again, very excited to be in this final, much like Lister... Davis Lister.
Yeah, I see a lot of quick strokes, and you know, one of the things that sort of just strikes me, they've got a 2-second penalty. They're not matching their strokes quite as well. Maybe they can pull together a little bit more synchronicity. If you're watching at home, look at the guy in the front. The guy in the back is trying to match those strokes, stroke for stroke, and they're having a hard time getting in sync.
Well, 3 seconds off the pace, so the Scantars are looking to perhaps taking the bond strategy.
Well, perhaps, yeah, the Scantar's looking comfortable for now. Yeah, I'd have to agree with you, Joe. Sometimes these guys, when they just look a bit off, it's maybe that the timing is such a crucial part of C2, getting you guys pulling together at the same time. And it actually takes less effort if you pull together to move the boat well than if you're both frantically fighting each other. And very hard move that for the C2s. We've seen those guys just drop off there. This is going to be disappointing for them, but you know, this happens against Slalom. What you have to do is you have to just finish the run to the best of your ability. Who knows what mistakes are going to come? This might salvage them a few places, and that ability to recover, even if it doesn't get them a medal today, might be in the future what gets them a result.
I remember for us at the 2002 World Championships in France, we had to paddle back up to make a gate, and it really turned our career around going to the 2004 Olympics in Athens. You never know what's going to turn it around. These guys got to keep moving forward.
You saw them 10 seconds down at the last split.
Yeah, it's disappointing for them, but I think they'll be really pleased to have made the final, and it's often that can be a really... Another touch coming there. Yeah, this is really not going well for them at the bottom of the course. It can be a hard way to finish it. Like these who perhaps it was a real excitement to make the final, to then finish on a bad run in the final, it can be mixed emotions. It can be hard to see the positive of you know, maybe at the start of this race, these guys would have said, if we can get to the final, that's a really good start.
And of course, David Florence coming from a very good system that has good coaching and good evaluation, and that's the coaching really comes into play now, how you digest what just took place on the course.
Yeah, everyone after this race is gonna go away, evaluate it, and there's, as always, Joe, you know, there's a lot more disappointed people than happy people.
Well, this morning we saw the Hochschorners not make it through, which was the second biggest surprise of the weekend.
Thank you. That's very kind, Matthew. I'll assume you're referring to myself there. No, yeah, it shows the nature of the sport. You know, last year's world champions have not really performed at this race.
Kasper Sindelar certainly knew how to perform at the top level.
Yeah, unfortunately we missed them on the top section there, but so we'll have to see how they're split. Looking not bad. It's going to be tight with a second up, so must have been a reasonable start. The Scanters were pretty solid on that top, and this Czech crew even taking a bit more out of them.
I think what I'm seeing right now, I think the bow man is being very deliberate in his strokes. He's setting a rate that the stern man can. These guys really seem to be working together now, but let's see how they do in this tricky, turbulent water right here.
As you saw the first split, there was second up.
Nicely done through here.
Yeah, very controlled there for C2 on a difficult move. Now, these guys really surprised me at the bottom on the first run, taking on the move above 18 to 19. It's a tough move, and let's see. Split's looking fantastic. 3 seconds up. They are taking on, going above. Can they get on? It looks like they've at least avoided a 50-second penalty, or have they? I'm not sure what happened with the back man on that bottom pole. It was really hard to tell from where we're looking, Joe. I'm not sure what your appraisal of that was. Messages will tell us soon enough.
Boy, there's just so much risk that goes into that 18-19 move in a C2, David. Getting above that curler wave, it's just rejecting you on the far side, and very hard to pull that together.
But let's say they're having not a bad time.
They've got a fantastic time. Wow.
Well, if that stays, if there's not a 50,
that stays.
Which it seems there's not. You know, you're allowed to hit the gates. You're allowed to go to make a right mess of them
from
by
our
hitting
angle
them,
on
as long
the
as you get through it. And from our angle, I'm not sure we can say by any means it was anything other than the judges have given it.
Absolutely.
Right,
and if we go back and we look at the rest of the run, these
well,
guys.
Here we go. There's one through.
Slightly out of sight of us there, but it looked like he just ducked his head under. He went behind the rock. We couldn't tell for definite there, Joe.
If we take away gate 19, these guys paddled so well through the course. I love their pacing and I love their synchronicity.
First of three French teams in the final, it's Pechier and Laborelle.
Yeah, these guys are really good to watch. Laborelle must be the lightest paddler in the whole of the men's field in any of the classes, and his back man is possibly one of the strongest. So it makes for some very exciting paddling. They can really throw that boat around, and doing a reasonable job at it so far.
Didn't make the Olympics, but they certainly cleared up in the World Cups, didn't they?
Yeah, it's so competitive in France in all the classes, and. Be a real disappointment for these guys not to have made that Olympic Games, but
we do have an asterisk against the Kasper Sindelar, so that'll have to be seen.
Presumably that means they're looking into that, but these guys are even faster than Kasper Sindelar were. Yeah, 0.93 up on them again. This is really good stuff.
I think the French are paddling really, really well right now, and I love the patience that Pechier is showing in the stern. Comes from a great slalom family. Brother Benoit, Olympic champion in 2004 in the kayak. The father, a world medalist as well. Very exciting the way this boat's paddling right now.
Yeah, just had to duck into that. Oh, they've been given a touch. I didn't actually see that, but it seems
14 officially.
Penalty. Okay. Maybe just clipped it on the way around. It's looking pretty windy out there, which makes it very difficult for these guys to judge, particularly the more technical sections. What are they going to do here, Joe?
I'm going low for these guys.
Yeah, same move again. As you can see, it does cost a bit of time paddling back up that eddy. It's the safer option.
I talked to the French coaches before the run. They said they were going to watch. They were going to see what the other boats were doing, and they would each make their own decision right at race time.
And maybe as the scant just didn't electrify the course, perhaps it's you guys know better.
Another penalty. So it picked up
on 21.
Another touch further down the course. Those are going to be pretty costly.
It's been moved them into provisional third place. To stress, we still have an asterisk against the provisional leaders, Casper and Sindler. Scantars are in second at the moment, and Labouré and Pechier have just moved themselves into third place. We've now had half the competitors go. Dave, your early conclusions?
Well, Casper and Sindler were fantastically fast. It's going to depend what happens with that penalty. Obviously, when this happens, an asterisk means that someone's maybe not sure. As said, we think maybe there was a 50, so the judges go, they look at the video, and they decide what the accurate call is on it. So it's not a nice situation ever. You know, these guys sitting waiting for that asterisk to go, but it was a fantastic run, and if it stays off, it's going to be hard to beat.
Poland, perhaps the boat you wouldn't expect in the final. It's Brzezinski and Brzezinski. Let's see how they go.
Yeah, these guys maybe in the shadow slightly of Pokwala Szczepanski, but those guys failing even to make it through the qualification stages here. And these guys have picked up a medal before in Tatsun, and when they get it right, they can look pretty good.
I see a lot of short, powerful strokes from these guys, and they're hitting a lot of strokes in sync. They're not too far out at 1.48 seconds out of the split.
Just see Richard Fox walking past with a huge smile on his face.
Yeah, I imagine. Happy it's gone his daughter's way this weekend. Yeah, not too far off of that first split, so you know, so much comes down to the bottom of the course. They're just going to try and get solid through this 14, 15, 16,
the
17.
Move.
Wow, that is impressive. And it done really neatly there. Most of the crews we've seen have been taking on the spin in 15. Those guys didn't hold back at all, just took it on direct and made a real smooth job of it.
All right, David, I'm going to put it back on you. Are these guys going lot?
I think they'll go low again. I think they'll go around.
Well, they're 2.79 seconds off.
Yeah, they've dropped a little bit of drift, and of course, I think they might have just clipped 19 going low. If you go around that, you've got to make sure and get that clean.
Yeah, otherwise they paddled really well through for a low line through there.
As you can see on the leaders board, we still have Casper Sindler going up. They've got guts, haven't they? They've been taking a couple of places, taking them on.
Yeah, it's going to be tight. Where are they? 114. It's going to be really, really tight for the guys in second and third. 121. Perhaps I was wrong about that. Touch is a bit windy out there, and maybe the pole just moved as they went past.
This is really important because they're clean, so they're definitely ahead of the Scantars. They're in provisional second place.
Yeah. Wow, only four boats to go. It's not been many clean runs, just the Brzezinskis and the Scantars, and all the rest picking up penalties. So getting a clean run is going to be pretty crucial for these remaining boats.
I think the Polish crew has a lot to be proud of on that run. I think they can really build off this. It does look like they may have taken a touch there, but that's in the judges' hands at this point.
Picot Bizot, the second of three French combinations to go today.
Yeah, impressive for the French to get three in the final. In the men's kayak, they had a incredible 1-2-3 on the podium, and even more incredibly, another three guys who are originally French who moved to other nations also in the final. So six French-born paddlers taking up the
next world number one, Etienne Dye, sticking it home, twiddling his
indeed.
Things.
Indeed. These guys,
big hit.
That was a bit of a careless touch there. They actually looked like in a pretty good place.
And I thought it was the best crossing of NEC2 we've seen so far. They would have had the fastest split so far. Plenty of time to make it up, though, on this course.
There is, with a good section down the bottom end of the course.
I like the look of this boat. I'm looking for people that are looking light and feeling like they're saving energy for the bottom of the course. But now's the time to push it in.
David Florence, Joe Jacoby, world champion, Olympic champion. It's great to have you on board. How are they going now?
Yeah, I think they've made a solid job through here. Nothing too electrifying, and obviously they were a fraction down at the split as a result of that penalty. They're going to need something pretty solid on the bottom, especially as Kasper Sindler was so quick here. 1.32 adrift. It's all to play for, really. Taking the bottom line, that's going to cost them a little bit of time, but can they get it clean and as quickly as possible?
I like the way they did that low line. I think it was one of the better maneuvers on the low line we've seen so far.
Really getting some really good vocal support.
A lot of French out supporting. I've been out in the stands earlier, French all there cheering.
Nice upstream.
They're on a pretty good time. They're not going to be challenging for the lead, but it's going to be...
Third place is
pretty tight.
4.6 seconds back. You need to look at 1:22. Well, they've gone into second place.
Second place. Wow. Still got that asterisk on Kasper Sindler, so we still don't know for absolute definite what their result is.
They must be sweating it out because they're in the top spot, but they must be aware that there's something hanging over them. It's going to be the longest 7 minutes of their life, but they're in a great position. Next to go, Klaus Besch from France, the scintillatingly fast team to watch.
Yeah, these guys have been very strong for the last few years. Remember, absolute devastation for them at the Olympic Games not to win a medal. But they've come back really strong, wearing the number one bib, as you can see. Oh, that's not a good start, though. Really, you need to be getting through these first gates on the course clean.
And these guys are really motoring up top. I mean, they can make it up, but it's just, are they really putting too much risk out too soon? You got to save something for the bottom of the course.
Well, it hasn't come up yet.
No, absolutely not. We'll have to wait for the judges on that. But it looks to me like another penalty. And the first penalty has certainly come up now. Wow, that was very fast, though. Very risky, but very fast. 2 seconds of another 2 seconds of penalties, so 2 seconds of drift at the split. Very quick, though.
New leader, French Pico Bizot. 50 seconds for Kasper Sindler.
We had suspected that might happen. That makes it not quite as hard times to chase now for these guys.
We'll see a confirmation on the screen in a couple of seconds, but that really throws the cat amongst the pigeons, doesn't it?
It does, it does. It'd be very disappointing for the Czech crew who, I don't know what they would have thought, whether they thought they got through that gate or not, but, you know, there's always the video and they're always going to come back to that and make sure they've got the decision right as best they can. These guys looking a bit adrift of the split as a result of all those penalties, but still certainly a chance to challenge for places 2 and 3.
Well, there were 4 seconds. We now have a asterisk against the third position's Brzezinski brothers. So at the moment it's Pico Bizot first, Skanter second. It's changing all the time. Let's see how this is going.
Yeah, it
as
is.
You can see on the screen in front of us what I've been talking about.
Another touch though for Klaus Pesch. That's not good. They really needed to keep this bottom part clean. Falling apart a bit. It's always sad to watch as a competitor myself. You want the guys to have good runs and the best guy to run to win, not to just see people making errors.
I'm sensing that there's a bit of a trajectory that has to go up through this course to race well, have something for the bottom. These guys were attacking so hard up top, you know, and then it kind of falls apart in that last up. They're pinned up against the rock. They're pushing off. They're losing valuable time.
Yeah, maybe that's what happened. Definitely you can sometimes get that phenomenon of trying too hard. And in this sport, you know, the actual effort you put through the blade doesn't always correlate to how fast you move down the course unless you're doing it with the right technique, with smoothness and in time.
Pico Bizot do have a medal now. Two competitors left on the course, Bozic, Taliat. They're very dynamic.
Yeah, well, just shows the strength of the French. That's probably what you'd think their third-rated boat that is now sitting at the top of the table.
You know, guys, it wasn't so long ago that the C2 family was really hoping Slovenia would arrive in this category. Strong men's kayaks, strong C1s. Now they really seem to be getting some good C2s out of this country. Very exciting for the sport.
Yeah, I love watching these guys. They're pretty light. They throw the boat around. The frontman sits so far back, so close to his backman a lot of the time that it makes
the half second up.
The boat easy. Wow, half a second up on, of course, that's on Pico Bizot, who've moved into the lead now. So these guys are challenging.
Dave, I really like your observation about the bow man leaning back. They're really moving their bodies closer to the center point of the boat, and it's making for really quick spins out on the water today.
Yeah, and let's see if they're going to get a quick spin in here. Yeah, pretty good, pretty solid. bit harder for the guys paddling on that side, so they've got their front man paddling on the left. It makes that spin a little bit more difficult for them, but they've done a pretty solid job of it. See these poles move. That's not the conditions they would have been hoping for, but they're just going to have to deal with that.
Well, here they come.
Wow, they're giving away a bit of time, so they were right
above.
On it at the
they're
first
going
split.
Above.
Taking on the real risky move. They obviously decided
Fortune
to go for it.
Favors the brave sometimes.
Indeed. not a bad attempt at that at all. I don't know if they picked up a penalty or not. It was certainly very, very close to that top pole.
Luca Bottas has seen this course,
but it was
more
quick
than most. He's in the C1s as well. It's now the time to go for, with penalties, 119. 119.6, as you can see. I think they're going to do it.
I think they got it.
Hey, we
wow.
We're 20 meters away and it's nearly broken my earphones. Look at the scream
Fantastic.
Of delight.
Yeah, those guys will be absolutely ecstatic. They've been good this year. They won in London. And always fast when they get it right.
I guarantee themselves a silver medal.
I spoke to the French coaches before this race. They thought doing the 18-19 move well above the gate would be worth about 3 seconds in the C2.
Well, they've taken a second off the field so far. Last to go, it's the Germans. Yeah. Anton Benzien, third and fourth, I believe, in the C1s, so they can only have a good weekend.
Yeah, we've seen a lot more of that. C1 paddlers and kayak paddlers getting into the C2 class, and these guys have been really strong.
Well, we're certainly going to have a new world champion. Who's it going to be?
Scantors will be waiting nervously, sat in bronze at the minute, to see if they're going to hang on for a medal or not.
Well, all the other appeals have come off. So far, it's Bozic, Taliat, Pico Bizet, and the Scantors. That's the order they are as they stand.
And I have to say, these guys are going to need a good run to beat that run of Bozic, Taliat. Looking good at the first split, though.
Well, they're up.
0.6 of a second. Of course, we've seen a lot of good first splits and a lot more to happen at the bottom of the course, but it's as good a start as they could hope for.
Such terrific C1 paddlers. They are used to taking risk, and they're doing it together in the C2 right now. It's making for a very exciting race.
Well, we saw in the K1 women, we saw it came down to the last one. It's done the same again.
Yeah, I think Fiona maybe thought she had it won in the K1 women. Bozic, Taliat probably think they're in a very good place, but these guys are going really well, holding it together. I'm very impressed.
I love the spin there. It was one of the best spins we've seen today.
I'm sure these guys are going to take this on direct, Joe.
we see the highlight.
3 seconds up.
Wow, they've got
Here
a huge
comes.
Advantage. They've taken two penalties there, but that's not going to be
Germans
worth it.
Germans don't miss penalties.
This is going to be tight.
It is, but they did save some time going.
They were
headed
three
the ball
up,
out of the
a
way.
50. They've been given a 50-second penalty.
Was that for deliberately heading it out of the way?
I really couldn't say.
Well, that's changed things. Let's hope they keep going.
Yeah, let's see what their time is going to be, because it's going to be a...
Ooh. Because that would have done it.
A very good time.
That would have done it. We don't know. This is suspense.
Clear of penalties.
We do not know. There is an appeal procedure. That's why Bozic and Taliat
and a star
jumping
an
up
asterisk
down.
Immediately.
So a quick, there were plus 47 at the finish line.
They would win by far.
They still have to have a touch added on. And this is we may not
Look,
know the
here we
outcome.
Go. He pushes it out of the way.
That's going to be the move. Is that one little head movement?
They touched
it?
Both 18 and 19 there. Yeah. So I think irrelevant as to what happens. It's looking like it's not up to me, of course. It's up to the judges. But it's looking to me like Bozic and Taliat have taken that.
Well, has the asterisk come off? They've certainly had a tremendous run, haven't they? We've had a few times this weekend that it has gone to. We had Fabien Lefebvre had to wait. We had Boys and Every wasn't sure.
And just to say what a kind of a watershed moment this would be for Slovenia to get a gold medal in a C2. This is a long time coming for this amazing slalom country.
We had a close call in Augsburg as well, didn't we, with the C2. Have the asterisks come off? It looks like there's no more asterisks. Well, that would show me that Bozic and Taliat are world champions. Pico Bizet second, Scantar in third. I can't see an asterisk, which means it's a result.
Yeah, it seems so. Scantar's there picking up a medal again. They've won medals the last two world championships. Slovenians, you know, a fantastic championship for them without who you would say is their absolute number one famous both. Peter Kauser out in injury, and you've had the C2 and the C1 step up to the mark and win medals for them.
I think in a year in which the Slovenian Canoe Federation lost their president, what a big moment this is to kind of really bring up the spirits of that slalom community to get that gold medal in the C2 event.
Yeah, great championship for the French. A medal in the C2, and again with probably the boat who you would say was their generally speaking, their third best boat. The Scantars winning, I believe, the only medal for Slovakia. Not a good championship for the Slovak team as a whole.
2 years to go till Rio, Mr. Florence.
Indeed, yeah. There's a lot of time for the next Olympics. I'm certainly going to have to up my game from this competition. There'll be a lot of guys going away evaluating what's happened, but for now, the guys who won will be celebrating, and really it's huge congratulations to all those that have got themselves on the podium and crowned themselves new world champions.
But if you've got a weak heart, you don't really want to watch this sport, do you?
We always want to watch this sport.
I can I can assure you that watching is less disappointing than taking part. So,
well. There looks like some connections.
Yeah, fantastic. Really pleased for those guys to come out here and win a world championship.
So 12 months ago, what were your first reactions? Just like, I can't believe it. Wow, because you'd set new history, hadn't you?
I mean, 12 months ago was absolutely incredible. I couldn't believe it. I wasn't sure if anyone would ever do it. Yeah, I was amazed. Things just went right for us.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Have a good trip home. We'll be with you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.